Hi everyone, this is GKCS. In today's video, we'll see how AI is validating a 2400-year-old philosophy from Plato. By the end of this video, you'll know some of the AI terms which are very useful right now if you're an engineer. And you'll also know maybe some of the philosophical terms which are super exciting but are rarely discussed in the AI space. So let's start. So around 400 BC, Plato came up with the idea that all objects have higher level representations. If I say apple, then you are probably thinking of a red apple. But some of you might think of a green apple. Some of you might think of a peeled apple. Some of you might think of an apple on a tree. Some of you might think of an apple in a fruit basket. All of those are apples. And so apple is not a physical reality. You can't look at a physical object and say that this is how all apples are like. But there is a higher level representation for the word apple. That representation is in some sort of information space. It's out of the physical space. Now, you have large language models which look at words and try to find the meaning or the complete information of those words. If there is some sort of Platonic relationship between the physical word apple and the higher level concept of apple that a large language model can describe accurately, then you can encode all information in the physical world into a large language model. That is where we are going towards. You'll see that there are some nuances here. This is not proven theory, it's still a hypothesis, but it's very interesting because the experiments are pointing towards its correctness. So the first thing which helps validate this hypothesis is that different models from different companies, where you have different engineers, different people with different ideologies, are coming up with large language models that share the same neural networks. So you take Llama, you take Gemma from Google, you take OpenAI, and if you lay out the neural network, you will see some components of these neural networks matching each other. Despite the training data being different, despite the architectures being different, despite their researchers being different, some of the neurons, some of the subgraphs you can imagine, are common. Why is this the case? It could be that they are all representing the same thing. At a high level, when you train these models, you all see the same reality. This was discovered by UC Berkeley and Google in 2023. It's an interesting piece, but it's not sufficient. It's just a starting point. Which brings us to our second point, which is most important. As these models scale, as you make these models from 3 billion parameters to 30 billion parameters, from 30 billion parameters to 300 billion parameters, the models get stronger and stronger, better at doing their jobs. And you know what? They all start to converge. The vector representations in these models start to converge to the same space, which means that as models get stronger, they are probably reflecting the real world or the actual information space that you want. But when they are weak, they might be differing from each other. Very interesting thought from Tolstoy here is that all happy families are the same, but unhappy families are unhappy in their own way. So small models are unhappy in their own way, but the larger models all agree to the same reality. This was discovered by Google Brain in 2023. An interesting point here is that even if you initialize the vectors to completely different values across models, they end up with the same values or converging towards the same values eventually. The third point is that these vector representations are getting even better if you use different types of training data. If I use image training data, I'm going to see human, 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 human. Okay, I understand what a human is in image. Now, if I start using the word, if I start constructing sentences with the word human, it turns out that the model, when trained on both kinds of data, gets better at its vector representation. It's kind of counterintuitive. You think that if you want to be an expert at speaking, then you should just focus on a lot of textual data. But that's not the case. You also should feed it image data. You also should feed it audio and video data. And OpenAI discovered this a while back. The whole point is that it seems like there are physical realities which can be represented in the information space. The way to do that is to look at all possible representations of that physical reality, image, audio, video, and then map them into a common single vector space. And I think the intuition here is that if you show a baby only audio, or if you give them only books, then they're not going to be able to understand the concept as well as if they have multiple sources of information representing the same thing. Models also seem to be behaving that way. They are getting smarter by getting different modalities for training. And the fourth point is really interesting. It's that these models are similar to how the brain processes information. Okay, I'll be a little careful here. It's nowhere near the human brain yet, but part of it is similar to how the human brain processes information. Exactly which part? When you give a large language model, when you talk to ChatGPT and you write some input text, it breaks it into words, breaks it into tokens, and those tokens are converted into vectors, okay, higher level representations. It seems like our brains also do something similar. So we hear information, or we see information, or we read information, and that information is broken into chunks. Each of those are some sort of concepts, and our brain then is able to map those concepts into a particular meaning. So if that is the case, then all the information that we are generating is coming from a higher dimensional space. And the best way to represent this higher dimensional space is a higher dimensional space from the model. The only difference here is that you have an n-dimensional information space in your head, and that n-dimensional information space is now being captured by the model. And some of you might be thinking, Gaurav, you're gone completely cuckoo now. You have completely lost it, but it's from UC Berkeley, it's from Microsoft Research, it's from Adobe, and then independently verified by, again, OpenAI and Microsoft later. It's not something which is scary, frankly, because yeah, sure, the models are learning from the human brain, but they are really accurate and they really follow the human brain's architecture is something interesting to know about. Okay, so we have these 4 points which are backing the Platonic hypothesis. Doesn't matter which organization you're in, doesn't matter who you are, there is a high level concept of all objects that we speak of. Flowers, you know what I'm talking about, I know what I'm talking about, but there is no physical flower that I can point to and you can point to and say that this is what we were talking about. Exactly, there's a concept, there's information space. Now, what could be the reason for this? Why is this even happening? There's three major points made by the paper, and I kind of agree with all three. The first one is that as you get better and better at doing different tasks, you become better as a general task manager, which means that if you're good at mathematics, you're good at tennis, you're good at chess, you're probably going to get good at painting also. At a high level, if you are able to do many tasks, you basically have general intelligence, which is being drawn from to do those smaller tasks. This would support the idea of IQ, where you have some sort of general intelligence which works across all domains. Specific intelligences like sports or music don't seem to fit with this hypothesis. The second reason for this could be as the models get larger and larger, they get smarter and smarter. So eventually they all agree on the same thing. Very smart people all agree on the same reality. The smaller models don't agree with each other because they haven't seen enough of the reality space yet. This looks like a classist way of describing things, but we'll leave it at that. The third point is from Richard Feynman, which says that if I want to describe something, then I should describe it simply. Okay, Albert Einstein also, I think, said that if I can't describe it to a 10-year-old or an 18-year-old, then I don't really understand it. I might have messed up the quotes there. But the basic idea is that if you are trying to understand something, then you have to understand it in a simple way. So the idea would be that as you get more and more data, as you do more and more research, as you gain more and more knowledge, the underlying concepts, they are going to align with each other much better, because the number of vector representations are much lesser here than there would be if you had very complex thoughts. Smarter people have lesser thoughts, fewer simpler thoughts. Complex or convoluted thoughts come from people who don't know much. So as you're scaling the models, they are converging to the same patterns. Okay, that's a lot to process, but finally, what is the implication of this? What does it mean to you and me? Basic idea is that if you're able to scale the models sufficiently, then eventually you'll reach a point where you don't need to train any other model on vector embeddings. Okay, you can just take the vector embeddings from one model and pass them on to the rest. So all this training time that you have for vector embeddings can be gotten rid of. Let's say Facebook does this for 10 years and they get the best vector representations. From now on, no one is going to waste their time finding vector representations. They are just going to pass these on to all other models in future. Most of the information in the world has been captured. The neural networks have been trained well enough. You don't need any different kind of vector representation. The way to think of this is that all languages in the world can converge to a single language, to a common language, and every human can comfortably describe whatever they want to say in that one language. Language was starting under the commons. All right, so that's something I wanted to share with you today. This is between philosophy and AI, which is both of these are very exciting spaces for me. And like I said, the implication is not yet true. The hypothesis has not been proven. We might see that no, all vector representations are different for different models eventually as you scale them enough, which is what happened with the concept of overfitting in AI. But thank you for watching. If you have any comments or suggestions on this, do let me know. If you like the video, do hit the like button. And if you want notifications for further videos, hit the subscribe button. I'll see you next time. I'll just shortly represent what I think is going to happen in the AI space, maybe in the next 5 to 10 years. I think some of the best philosophers across history are going to be either validated or invalidated with AI. I know it sounds like really stupid maybe to say this directly, but Nietzsche, there's Kant, there's quite a few people who are either accepted or proven wrong using neuroscience, using sciences in general. And AI is a field where a lot of information theory can be validated, which means that the more we invest in this space, the more we'll know about our own existence. And that is really, really both humbling and scary. Like for me to understand who I am in the next 5 to 10 years, I think that's fine. Yeah, I mean, we kind of know each other, but at the same time, it is a bit scary to know that this is what the reality is. You can't change it. There's no thought that you can have around it. This is the fact. Let's see.